I want you to have a look at this. I got this letter from Madras, India, written by some clerk.
Why do you want me to look at it, Hardy?
Because it has some of the most advanced mathematics I've ever seen. And this person claims he's just 23 years old. I want you to tell me what you think.
Do you think someone might be pulling a prank?
That's what I first thought. But someone pulling a prank wouldn't know higher level maths than me in my own field, right?
Godfrey Hardy replied to that young man, and he wrote back, little did Hardy know that he had just begun correspondence with probably the greatest mathematician that ever lived. Hi, my name's Pranav, you're watching scienceisdope, and this is the story of Srinivasa Ramanujan. To see where the story began, we have to travel back a couple of years, from Cambridge to Kumbakonam, a small temple town in present-day Tamil Nadu, India. It's the early 1900s and India is under British colonial rule. A 16-year-old Srinivasa Ramanujan rushes home excitedly to tell his mother the good news. His talent for mathematics has been recognized and he has been given a scholarship from the Government Arts College, Kumbakonam. On hearing this news, his mother is delighted and in gratitude begins preparing a puja or a worship for their family deity, the Hindu goddess Namagiri. Ramanujan fell in love with mathematics at a young age. However, he did not have access to the best books and journals. He went to the local library, borrowed books from friends and people he knew, and used whatever resources he could get his hands on to teach himself mathematics. He explored the subject in isolation from the academic community and independently rediscovered some theorems that were already known. Teaching yourself something can be one of the most satisfying things in the world, but luckily for you, you don't have to do it in isolation like Ramanujan did, thanks to this video sponsor, Cambly. Cambly is the only app in India that provides one-on-one private English classes with tutors from USA, UK, Canada, basically native speakers of the language. As anyone who's ever tried to learn a new language can tell you, it's much easier to learn with a native speaker guiding you. Cambly is especially useful for those who know how to read and write, but struggle with speaking English confidently. You can choose from various courses like Business English, IELTS, Personality Development, etc. Tutors on Cambly are extremely friendly and will help you improve your weak areas without any judgment. Here's the interaction I had with one of their tutors.
What does everyone have the most trouble with usually?
In my experience, most people are on Cambly to improve their communication skills, to build confidence and have the ability to speak fluently without pausing to think all the time or struggling to put words together. So it's just putting the time into practice.
My viewers can get 22% off any 3-month plan by using the code 22SID. The link is in the description. And now back to the video. Ramanujan secures the scholarship and sets off to college, but there he faces a dilemma. In addition to math, he has to study other subjects that don't really interest him. He fails all his other papers not once but twice. Because he failed his exams, he doesn't get the degree and he loses his scholarship, his only source of income. And things only get worse around this time because his parents get him married. And he now has 2 mouths to feed. He moves to Madras, present-day Chennai, and after a lot of shuffling around, he lands the position of an accounting clerk in the post office of Madras. But he never really gives up on math. In his free time, Ramanujan continues his research independently. He shares his body of work with the best math professors in Madras. Impressed, they encourage him to go beyond. Beyond Madras, beyond India, to Cambridge, England. He writes letters to mathematicians at Cambridge University, and one such mathematician is G.H. Hardy. one of the most celebrated at the time. It's a short letter and I encourage you to read it after watching this video. I'll leave a link in the description. He begins the letter by introducing himself as a clerk with no university education. He goes on to say that he has discovered many interesting theorems that might interest Hardy. And then he followed that up with 9 pages of mathematical equations, some of which you may be familiar with. Hardy is baffled on reading this letter, which brings us to the start of the video. The two men having dinner were Godfrey Hardy and his colleague John Littlewood. In his letter, Ramanujan had written down equations but not their proofs. So naturally, Littlewood was a little suspicious of the validity of what he had written. He expresses his suspicions to Hardy, to which Hardy replies that the theorems in this letter must be true, because if they were not true, no one would have the imagination to invent them. Hardy was, after all, one of the smartest mathematicians at the time, so it would take something very impressive to catch his attention. What was in that letter that impressed Hardy so much? Let's dive into it. There were 3 kinds of equations in the letter. Equations already known and proven. Because Ramanujan worked in isolation, he did not know that they had already been proven. Equations that were new and interesting but not important. Equations that were new and also groundbreaking. The third type was what caught Hardy's attention. How could someone with no formal mathematical background come up with these insightful results that eluded even the most accomplished mathematicians? One such groundbreaking discovery was a solution to the problem of finding a distribution for prime numbers. Prime numbers are those that don't have any factors other than 1 and itself. For example, 5 and 7 are prime, whereas a number like 4 can be written as 2 times 2 and therefore is not prime. Now let's take some examples and count the number of prime numbers less than or equal to a given number n. We'll call this or represent this as P of n. So P of 5 will be the number of prime numbers less than or equal to 5. So 2, 3, and 5. So P of 5 is 3. Similarly, P of 7 is 4. And P of 18 is 7. As we increase the value of n, P of n keeps increasing. What do you think will happen if we keep increasing n? Yeah, it blows up pretty quickly. Can you find a pattern among these numbers or a formula that will tell you exactly how many primes there are less than or equal to that number? Well, we could count up all the primes one by one, but that becomes impractical for these really large numbers. For centuries, this problem had kept several mathematicians awake at night, and it had been tackled by giants like Gauss and Legendre and Riemann, but they had all failed. Ramanujan, however, claimed he had a solution to this problem that had eluded everyone. Now, in fairness, the solution that Ramanujan had was not precise. However, for very large numbers, this formula gave an approximation that was better than anything else we had at the time. This was what Hardy saw in Ramanujan, a great and insightful young mathematician with raw talent. If he could achieve so much without a university education, was there a limit to what he could do with proper training? So this is what happened. Hardy just had to meet this mathematical genius. So he invites Ramanujan to come over to Cambridge and collaborate with him. There was only one problem. As a Brahmin, it was considered dishonorable for him to cross the sea. This fact, along with objections from his mother, meant Ramanujan did not travel to Cambridge. Him and Hardy kept correspondence through letters until one day his mother came and told him that he should go to Cambridge. When asked why she suddenly changed her mind, she said that the goddess Namagiri appeared in her dream and told her to not stand in the way of Ramanujan achieving his ambition. An ecstatic Ramanujan packs his bags and sets sail across the ocean. His destination, Cambridge University. This trip would change his life. Hardy, a white British man who was an atheist, and Ramanujan, a deeply religious dark-skinned Hindu, formed an unlikely partnership. Not only did they differ in their religious and cultural backgrounds, but their mathematical philosophies were poles apart. Hardy was a proponent of rigor in mathematics and the importance of a formal proof. Once Bertrand Russell, another famous English philosopher, was mocking Hardy and he replied, "If I could prove by logic that you were going to die in 5 minutes, I should be sorry you were going to die. But my soul would be very much mitigated by the pleasure in the proof." Yeah, classic Hardy. On the other hand, Ramanujan believed in intuition above all. If an equation made intuitive sense to him, then he wouldn't bother with a proof. He believed that theorems manifested in his mind, and for him, an equation had no meaning unless it expressed a thought of God. Despite their many differences, they had one thing in common: an avid love for mathematics, and that's all that mattered. In Cambridge, Hardy started dissecting Ramanujan's notebook, which had all of his discoveries. There were a lot of equations, but no formal proof for any of them. In mathematics, each idea needs to be accompanied by a watertight proof that explains why it's true. Only then does the mathematical community accept it. Ramanujan did not have this. And working in isolation, he did not know much about how to write them either. So with the help of Hardy, he began learning different techniques and applying them to his equations. And one by one, the dominoes started falling. Over the course of 5 years, they were able to prove nearly all the theorems in his notebooks. Some, like the prime number formula, turned out to be false, but these were a few mere exceptions. Equipped with this success, they set their sights on other areas of mathematics. They went on to work on number theory, infinite series, continuous functions, and mathematical analysis. Now, we're not going to go into detail on all his work, we'll look at just one. The theory of partition. A partition of a number is its decomposition into smaller numbers. For example, 3 can be partitioned as 2 plus 1. If we were to list down all the partitions of 3, they would be 3 plus 0 and 2 plus 1. We write this as P of 3 is equal to 2. Here, P of n is a function that counts the number of partitions of a number n. Similarly, 4 has 5 partitions, so P of 4 is 5. If we keep doing this, we notice that the numbers start blowing up really fast. Can you find a pattern here? It's not as easy as it seems. In fact, finding a formula for the partitions of a number, or P of n, was an open, hot problem in mathematics at the time. Mathematicians all over the world had set their sights on it, but were unable to make a dent in this daunting puzzle. Enter Ramanujan and Hardy. They came up with an infinite series which, when evaluated, gave the exact number of partitions for any number n. This was a remarkable feat that did not go unnoticed. Ramanujan was elected as a fellow of the Trinity College, Cambridge, and was only the second Indian to receive that honor. This partnership had made its name in the annals of mathematics. Their future looked bright, but there was going to be a twist in this tale. And this twist would be a rather tragic one. Around 1919, Ramanujan was diagnosed with tuberculosis and moved back to Kumbakonam, his hometown. A year later, he breathed his last. He was only 32 years old. But in his brief life, he created a legacy that stood the test of time. This video, however, is not over until I address one of the most common comments I get. One of the things that Ramanujan said was that the goddess Namagiri, his family deity, was the one who manifested the theorems and formulae in his mind. And many people use this as an argument in support of their religion or the existence of God. So let's address this. René Descartes, he was a famous French mathematician. You might have heard of the Cartesian coordinate system that is named after him. Descartes, in his book Meditations, like Ramanujan, claimed that God was the source of his knowledge and mathematical ability. He said that without God, there would be no knowledge and everything derives meaning from the Supreme Being. And he was a devout Catholic believing in the Christian God. Or consider Carl Friedrich Gauss, who, after finding the solution to a difficult problem, once said, "Finally, 2 days ago, I succeeded not on account of my hard efforts, but by the grace of the Lord." like a sudden flash of lightning, the riddle was solved. And he was a Lutheran, a branch of Protestants within Christianity. So do these examples prove that the Christian God exists? Of course not. They are reasons that these mathematicians attributed to their own intuitions. This can be due to biases they developed during their upbringing or maybe later in life. Now take the case of Hardy himself. He was a great mathematician and a staunch atheist. In fact, you can find a lot of mathematicians with great intuitions who are atheists throughout their career. I think I've made my point. Now let's try and understand why Ramanujan might have claimed God as Namagiri was the reason behind his mathematical ability. Intuition, or the ability to visualize complex ideas, is a great skill in mathematics. All famous mathematicians have it in some measure. Ramanujan had an abundance of it. Right from his childhood, he worked tirelessly for many years to cultivate this art. He was able to visualize complex mathematical ideas in his mind effortlessly. People with great intuitive ability go from step 1 to step 20, skipping all the steps in between. And sometimes they themselves don't know how they did it. And when they don't know something, that's where you tend to see these kinds of explanations. Ramanujan had a very religious upbringing, and he was inclined to think that his ability was a gift from God. Doesn't mean it's true. And just because he was an expert in math doesn't mean everything else he said was also correct. His authority is not evidence for his statements. Try and guess which logical fallacy this is in the comments. But if there's one thing we can all agree on and for which there's ample evidence, it's that Ramanujan was an unparalleled genius. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.